Oh, interesting. Okay, I'm going to start the webinar. We're streaming right now, just so you know. I'm going to start the webinar. She's saying she's getting a message that it's not, the meeting hasn't started, which I'm not sure why that is, but we are streaming right now. But I just wanted to let you know that I'm going to start, it'll start televising when I start this. Now we're live.
Okay, well, maybe I'll call the meeting to order and we won't do anything substantive until Julie joins us. But I'm going to call the February 18th, 2021, regular meeting of the Planning Commission. Commission to order. Could we have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Dawson? Greenberg?
You're muted, Miriam.
Here.
Maxwell?
Here.
Appearing with the space bar. Nielsen?
Here.
Spellman?
Here.
Schifrin?
Here.
And Commissioner Conway is present, but not on audio, for the record.
Okay, everyone's here. Are there any statements of disqualification? Is there anybody in the audience here to speak on oral communications?
There is one phone call, a listener who has not indicated that they wish to address the commission at oral communications.
Well, this is the time for anyone to address the commission on an item that is not on our agenda for tonight, but is probably before the commission. If you could just identify yourself, you'll have 3 minutes. If you want to tell the person what to do, if they want to talk.
If you would like to speak at oral communications, please press star 9. I don't see anybody recognized.
Julie, can you hear us? Okay, so I'm going to go through the minutes, and if you have problems, I'll put them off till you can get on. Otherwise, you can just shake your head yes if you want to vote yes. So let's hear, we're going to approve a number of minutes, the approval of the minutes of December 3rd. Does anybody have anything you want to say about those minutes? Hearing nothing, would somebody like to move approval of the minutes of December 3rd? I think it should be 2020. We haven't quite gotten to.
Oh my goodness.
I'll move approval of those minutes.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
We moved in second. Could we have a roll call vote, please? And Julie, you can just shake your head. Yes or no?
Commissioner Dawson?
Aye.
Greenberg?
Aye.
Maxwell?
Aye.
Nielsen?
Aye.
Spellman?
Aye.
Conway? Affirmatively responded. Chair Schifrin?
Aye. So we'll now move on to the minutes of December 17th, 2020. Are there any comments on the minutes? Would somebody like to move approval of the minutes of December 17th, 2020?
I'll move approval of those minutes.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion? Can we have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Dawson?
Aye.
Greenberg?
Aye.
Maxwell?
Aye.
Nielsen?
Aye.
Spellman?
Aye.
Commissioner Conway? Conway has indicated aye. Commissioner Schiffer?
Aye. Passes unanimously. We'll now move on to the approval of the minutes of January 7th, 2021. Is there any discussion on the minutes? Would somebody like to move approval of the minutes?
I'll move approval of those minutes.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion? Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Dawson?
Aye.
Greenberg?
Aye.
Maxwell?
Aye.
Nielsen?
Aye.
Spellman?
Aye.
Chair Shepard?
Aye.
Commissioner Conway?
Do you want to give us a thumbs up? Not sure she can hear us.
Are we allowed to, could I text her, or is that not allowed?
I've texted her. I'm going to have Sarah text her.
Okay.
Julie, can you hear us? Did you vote aye on the last minutes? Okay, so it's unanimous.
Oh, I'm going to call her.
Maybe I can, Julie, let me suggest, can you hear me? Let me suggest something. Since Julie was on the subcommittee that looked at the next item, which is the public hearing item, maybe we, while staff is trying to get her connected to audio, we could get a staff report. And then hopefully she'll be on by the time we're ready for the commissioners to talk. Is that okay with you, Julie, that we have the staff report? We can't hear you. Oh, she's not talking to us.
I hope it's not just that her phone is on mute or something easy.
Well, she's done this before, so.
Call in and you could add it.
She's trying to do what she needs to do.
So why don't you call in as an attendee instead of a panelist, and then I can elevate you to panelist, and that might work. Yeah, so just call in like a regular Joe.
Maybe she doesn't know she needs to, like, turn the audio up on her computer.
I think we might have it figured out.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Testing?
It works.
Okay. Jesse just called in.
I did. I'm so sorry about this. I've been working at it for a while.
It's not ideal, but I've had her call in as an attendee, and I'm going to try and elevate her, but she should be able to participate. You'll just see her number there as well.
Okay, so if there's no objection, why don't we get a staff report on item number 4, which is going to be a public hearing on an ordinance amendment to Title 24.
I'm going to share my screen. Can everybody see that?
Yes. Yeah, I can.
Yes.
Excellent, thank you. Good evening, Chair and Commissioners. We're presenting to you tonight the remaining inclusionary ordinance amendments that staff and the Housing Subcommittee worked on over the last several months. Here is the recommendation that is being considered to add an alternative for compliance that would allow employer-sponsored housing as an inclusionary option for residential rental development. So why are we proposing an employee-sponsored housing amendment tonight? At the December 12th, 2019 City Council meeting, the Council provided direction to explore ways to make the inclusionary ordinance more effective for workforce housing projects. At that same meeting, the Santa Cruz City Schools District raised concerns on the increase of the city's inclusionary requirement to 20% and how that would impact the feasibility of their proposed employee housing project. The goal of this proposed ordinance amendment is to help provide more opportunities for affordable housing that retain the local workforce. Since we last presented this item to you on the December 17th Planning Commission, the Housing Subcommittee has been reestablished and we've met three times to analyze and review draft revisions based on the feedback we received. And following are the main elements of the revised school district amendment. So first, this is for rental development only. For this housing that would be located on school district owned land, school districts are allowed to prioritize and restrict occupancy to school districts, teachers, and staff. School districts may also allow local public employees that live and or work in the city or county of Santa Cruz first, and then other members of the public to occupy the housing, but school district employees would have priority. The majority of the housing must be for qualifying low and moderate income households, and at least 75% of the housing must be rented to eligible employees. Now, we've had some questions from the public that I'd like to address. One is whether this school district section would apply to UCSD. To clarify, we had proposed to include a definition in our ordinance for teacher and school district employees that is based on the state law's definition. This definition states that it is limited to employees of a unified school district, including pre-kindergarten through grade 12. Since UCSD is not part of a unified school district, this particular school district sponsored housing amendment would not apply. Another question that was raised is on how this would impact current zoning, environmental review, and public process. While State Assembly Bill 3308 supports housing for school district staff and teachers on school district-owned land, it does also state that the housing must not violate any other applicable laws. These would still be in full force and effect. There was also another question on what happens if an employee is no longer eligible. In this proposed ordinance, we require that the school district would provide a management plan to address any of these issues prior to final building inspection or certificate of occupancy. So I do also have some late breaking news. While the school district has been provided the opportunity to review all of the revised draft versions since we began this process, the school district just communicated this afternoon that they still prefer the version that was proposed to the Planning Commission on December 17th because it simply follows state law, which already supersedes our city ordinance. They were very apologetic for this late-breaking update, but they've been completely overwhelmed with trying to create a plan for reopening our schools in the midst of this global pandemic. Council has asked us to be responsive to the school district needs, and we want to be respectful of that. So we're hoping this will be helpful to inform our discussions tonight. I do have the December 17th version available if the commission would like to review this later on. In the meantime, I'll move on to the general employer-sponsored housing section. So this section is the same as the school district-sponsored housing requirements, except that for housing on employer-owned land, employers are allowed to prioritize and restrict occupancy to their own low and moderate income employees. The employers may also allow members of the public that live and or work in the city or county of Santa Cruz to occupy the housing, but the employer's own employees would have priority. Then the housing must have a greater number of affordable units than the inclusionary requirement, but could have a broader range of affordability if the employer provides rents affordable to its employees, and this must be demonstrated. The majority must be for low and moderate income households. Again, this is new. The majority of the rental units must receive public funding from local, state, or federal funds, affordable housing funds, or affordable housing tax credits. So again, this is the recommendation that we have before you to consider tonight. That would be to recommend the council add an alternative for compliance that would allow employer-sponsored housing as an inclusionary option for residential rental development projects. And I'm available to take any questions. I know since the subcommittee helped us, you know, we appreciate all of their help here. If they would like to respond with any comments first, I'd like to open it up to them.
I have a question. Could you summarize what's the difference between the ordinance on the school district, the ordinance that would apply to the school district that's before the commission tonight, and what was in the December 17th ordinance? How is it
different? I lost my screen. Hang on 1 second. I can actually pull it up for you. So here's the version that was presented to the Planning Commission on December 17th. It very much follows the state law and essentially references the codes for the state law.
So this is the whole ordinance?
For the school district-sponsored housing section, yes.
And you don't have that law. I think it might be helpful to go through the law because much of what was in the proposed ordinance was also in the law, right?
Correct. I think what the school district is really trying to kind of hone in on is that the state law is going to supersede any of our city code anyways, and what would be potentially an issue is if we somehow in the way that we communicate in our ordinance sort of end up conflicting with the state law, that it's much simpler to just reference that, you know, the school district needs to follow the state law in terms of providing this code, which does encompass the AB 3308, which I know was something the Planning Commission wanted to make sure that the, you know, school district would be following that code.
Any other commissioners want to, members of the committee want to weigh in? Does the staff recommend that we do this, that we agree to what the school district is asking?
I mean, like I said, this just came about after 5:30 tonight, so we're kind of looking at it, revisiting it again with you side by side. It was the original version that we proposed in December, and it was approved by recommended by our legal counsel, you know, essentially to avoid any conflicts with state law. So haven't gotten there yet, but I mean, we did agree with it at one point, so it would probably be worthwhile to revisit it here tonight if commission is open to doing that.
Hey, other commissioners have any comments on the school district amendment or the general employer amendment?
Can you see me?
See who?
This is Julie. I'm not sure if you can see me.
I can't see you, but maybe you could, Jessica, would you?
My.
Open up the screen, then we can see everybody.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
See.
Okay, now we
there.
Can.
Okay. That's so funny. I can see myself, but so thank you, and I apologize for the awkwardness. I would just like to say that, I mean, it is awkward. It's very late. First and foremost, I have to say I know the school district is scrambling, and definitely get a bit of latitude on that. I think that considering what they're saying, that we should go with the language that was proposed earlier, which conforms with state law. And I think there's a couple of reasons for that. One of them is that it's always simpler to have our ordinance mirror state law, just to avoid confusion, and we're creating something new right here. And I think that it's more straightforward to do so. Also, out of respect for both our charge from the council and for the school district, I would be supportive of going back to the language from December. Thank you.
Anybody, Commissioner Greenberg? You're muted.
Sorry about that. I was just agreeing that that's the simplest, most straightforward thing. It's the best thing for us to do, legally speaking. And, you know, if we had sort of, you know, it's unfortunately we didn't think of doing that initially, I suppose, but that's fine. It makes sense, and I agree we should do it now. So that's fine.
I think so. I pulled up the law, and I'm trying to, it does say, trying to see what authority it gives the purpose of this part is to facilitate the acquisition, construction, rehabilitation, and preservation of affordable rental housing for school district employees. So it's for affordable rental housing. Restricts it to teacher or school district employees, but they may allow other public employees or members of the public, but they retain the right to prioritize. There's a definition of affordable rental housing, which is low or moderate as defined in the section of state law that defines that. I think that's it. I think one of the reasons we changed the ordinance is that there were questions that we had. What happens if a teacher is no longer working for the district and moves out? I think the only real difference is that there was a requirement for a management plan that at least 75% of the units be for teachers or employees. And neither one of those are in the one of those requirements are in the state law. So I don't feel that strongly about it. I think huge majority is going, the units have to be affordable. Low and moderate income employees and teachers. That seems fine to me. So I'm okay with I'm okay with that. I would, you know, it's sort of like, wish there was more of a dialogue, but I understand the problems that they're operating. So I think it's important to move this forward so that the school district has certainty. Ordinance, I'm always a little bit concerned where an ordinance just refers to state law because, you know, then people have to scurry around and try to find the state law section. So, I mean, I'm happy to approve what they're asking for, but I wonder whether it would make sense when this goes to the council to have the state law provision spelled out in the ordinance itself so that anybody who reads it will know what they are rather than just say, I think that's not the best way for the city to write it. Other commissioners have comments, again, either about the school district ordinance or the general employer sponsor. There was a member of the audience. I'm going to open the public hearing and see if the person in the audience wanted to speak to, who we called up, wanted to speak to this item. And if so, they would have 3 minutes to provide us their testimony.
Again, if anyone wishes to address the commission on this topic, please press star 9 to be recognized.
Okay, seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing and bring the matter back to the commission for discussion and action. So, one of the issues was around whether, you know, well, why don't we deal with the two ordinance amendments separately? So the first one would be the school district one. But I see it that we have sort of four options. One is to just say no. The other is to approve what the subcommittee came up with, which isn't what the school district wants. Third is to just simply approve the language that just refers to state law. The other final one would be to approve the language that refers to state law, but also lists the sort of state law, the relevant state law provisions. Anybody want to say anything about any of those or make a motion to approve one of them? Conway?
Yeah, thanks for breaking it out that way. I would move that we would pursue your option number 3, Chair Schifrin, which is to forward to the council the language of state law that was recommended by our attorney, and I believe it was included in the version from December. Is that right, Jessica? Yeah. So to revert to the language that was proposed in December and forward that to the council.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second that.
You know, I brought up that ordinance from the December 17th meeting, and what would you clarify your motion? We had an ordinance presented to us tonight.
Okay.
Theoretically represented what was before us on the 17th. When I pulled up the one that was
yeah.
on
a good point.
You want to, your motion is to cover the one that we had before, brought up before us this evening, which was like...
You know, yeah, and I apologize, you can't conflate when you're actually both looking at them. What my intention was to move the language as proposed tonight, which was accepted by the school district and recommended by our council.
Who seconded the motion?
I think it was Christian. Nielsen got it first.
Okay, I wasn't sure.
Acceptable to you.
Yeah, that's fine.
Is there any further discussion on the motion? Let's have a roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Conway?
Aye.
Dawson?
Aye.
Greenberg?
Aye.
Maxwell?
Aye.
Nielsen?
Aye.
Spellman?
Aye.
Chair Schifrin?
Aye. It passes unanimously. Okay, so we'll now move to the general employer-sponsored housing ordinance. Is there any discussion from commissioners on this ordinance? Yes, Commissioner Conway.
Thank you. This isn't a proposal to change. I just do want to recognize that with this ordinance, we are suggesting that a non-school district is eligible if there's public funding. And with public funding in a project, it actually does make it a very different kind of a project. So I just want to recognize that we are, through the relief that we're providing to employer developers of housing, by adding that requirement, it actually, let me just say, muddies the water. I just want to recognize that. You know, I'm not proposing that we change the language, which we talked about at quite a bit of length. But what we're really asking employers to do here is to seek public funding and build, which would mean that they'd be building 100% affordable projects, which aren't subject to our ordinance in the same way. I just wanted to recognize that in the record.
Thank you. And let me say that from my point of view, I was not supportive of having an ordinance that applied to private employers and pushed for public and nonprofits to be covered by the ordinance. And I finally agreed to support this, kind of coming from the opposite direction, which is I was worried that if without something like this, what we get is all moderate income housing and there wouldn't be any low income housing. This seemed really important that we do try to encourage housing for low income employees as well. This was the compromise we came up with. I backed off from the, you know, trying to just have it apply to public and nonprofits, and Commissioner Conway option, which, you know, there are more, seem to be more programs that are available for moderate income as well. So we'll see how it plays out. I'm concerned with some of the big employers, and I think they can afford to do a 20%. So if they don't want to use this. So anyway, that's the background. Commissioner Greenway, if you want to, as a third member of our
Yeah, I just wanted to agree and to say that I think that this is a good middle road and a good way to ensure that the largest number of employers can participate, which would include any, most likely larger employers in Santa Cruz, from public, state sector, federal sector, as well as in local public employees, as well as, let's say a large hotel or a large supermarket or something like this, who might want to figure out, as well as obviously nonprofits like hospitals, but also private employers that might be interested in creating housing for their low-income and moderate-income employees. And I would just say that Commissioner Schifrin's point about the potential for additional funding sources to be available for, the missing middle moderate-income local employees may become available. We're talking about having a presentation by CalCHA, for instance, which is apparently interested in helping to provide and has a track record of providing that kind of housing across the state. So we would be prepared for that as well. So I really appreciated the process we went through in crafting this ordinance. Thank you.
Any other commissioners want to say anything about this? So would somebody like to make a motion to approve the staff and subcommittee recommendation for the employer-sponsored housing?
I'll make a motion to approve both of those. And I'll second that.
Second by Commissioner Maxwell, a motion by Commissioner Spellman. Is there any further discussion? None, could we have a roll call, please?
Aye.
Dawson?
No.
Greenberg?
Aye.
Maxwell?
Aye.
Nielsen?
Aye.
Spellman?
Aye.
Chair Schiffer?
Aye. Passes on a 6-1 vote. Thank you very much. We move on to information items. We have information items, please. Thank you, Jessica, for all your work on this.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Jessica and Jess did an amazing job in organizing us for many weeks. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We're excited to have more affordable housing on tap.
Okay, let's move on. Are there, the staff have any information items?
I don't.
Here's Matt.
Hi, Chair Schifrin. Hi, this is Matt Benoit, Principal Planner. So just a quick report out. 418 Pennsylvania went to council, and council denied the appeal on that project and approved the development on a 5-2 vote. And then my other items are future agenda items. Do you want me to discuss them now or wait for that next item later?
Why don't you talk about it now?
Okay, sure. So for some future items, we have the objective standards community meeting on March 11th. And we've sent out a poll to the commissioners here on whether they would like to attend. And if we do have a quorum of planning commissioners, then it will be formally noticed as a planning commission meeting. And so far we've heard back, we've had three responses and have three yeses to attend. So it's likely that we will have a quorum for that. So
we do.
Keep that in mind. We'll be noticing that as a planning commission meeting most likely, and that's again on March 11th. We don't have an exact time yet for that, but stay tuned. Information will come out soon on that. We currently have no items for the March 4th meeting, which I think, since this item wasn't continued tonight, we'll likely not have anything going for that date. And then 318 were tentatively scheduled for the 555 Pacific Developer Agreement Amendment. That's tentative at this point. And then April 1st, our meeting will feature an informational update on the report of the general plan and housing element.
Okay.
And then finally, May 6th, we have on our calendar right now the CIP and general plan consistency findings, which need to be approved by Planning Commission prior to the City Council passing a budget in June per state law. So you'll see that coming your way soon as well. And then, of course, we don't have yet beyond the community meeting for objective standards in March. We don't yet have a check-in plan for Planning Commission, but stay tuned for that as well, because once our consultant does additional work on that item, we'll be reporting back to Planning Commission kind of about quarterly as we planned. So, thank you.
More about things. About the 555 Pacific, you said there's going to be discussion of 555 Pacific Development Agreement. What's that all about?
Jessica, are you available to speak at all to that? Pacific Development Agreement.
Yeah, I don't know if that item would actually come to Planning Commission. I think it would go to Council. Is this for the Council and Planning Commission agenda, or just Planning Commission?
Just Planning Commission. It was currently on our calendar, but that's tentative, so maybe it's just going to Council. So.
Yeah, I think it would just be going to Council, and the developer has come to talk to us about some issues that they're having with tenancy, and the project is struggling is what they're telling us. So I don't have any more information to give. We're trying to work through looking at their, you know, pro forma and rent roll and what's happening. But I don't have any more information to provide at this point, other than that they have communicated that they're having some issues and want to reopen the original DA, the development agreement.
So that's the development at the where Front Street and Pacific, where Front Street comes in. Many years ago. Okay, I'm
now. Boomerang.
That's pretty interesting. Usually a development agreement is like a zoning ordinance change. So I would think it would go to the Planning Commission, but maybe once it's. At least I know what you're talking about. So we may.
Yes, and it may or may not go forward. It's still very tentative at the moment, so I will let you know as soon as we know more.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Thanks, Jessica.
No problem.
So no more information items. So we'll move on to subcommittee advisory body reports, and I wanted to talk a little bit about the housing subcommittee, because we had a very active discussion about what future work would the subcommittee, might the subcommittee have. And I just wanted to, there was some need for greater clarity about what the committee's charge was, or the commission's charge. And I thought it was, interesting, in the staff report where it referred to the council action that directed staff to review and bring back amendments in terms of inconsistencies created by ordinance amendments to the Planning Commission, but also to refer to the revised inclusionary housing ordinance to the Planning Commission and direct the commission and staff to work with community stakeholders options for making the ordinance more effective, including one, provisions to streamline its operation and to increase requirements. So I think we did part of that with Section 8, but I think from my perspective there's more that could be done. The second was to give a priority regarding flexibility in workforce housing, which I think we tried to. So the subcommittee is going to have a general subsequent subsequent meeting to sort of talk about possibilities with the recognition that staff is maxed out. The housing staff is completely immersed in trying to move forward a number of affordable housing projects, and they really don't have time to provide staff to the subcommittee. So I think the intention is just for the subcommittee members to meet and discuss, you know, issues and possible things that could be pursued. Did I reflect the discussion accurately? The other issue that I brought up there had to do with the replacement housing ordinance, and I appreciate that getting back to me on that. I know that there's currently what I consider an inconsistency in the ordinance, in the overall code, because the section on replacement housing just talks about, you know, you need to demolish 3 affordable units that have to have a replacement housing requirement, but the state law and the density bonus law requires that if an affordable unit is demolished as part of a density bonus project, it needs to be replaced on a one-to-one basis. Now, in the research I did, the density bonus ordinance does recognize that, but this is another one of my concerns about referring people to state law. It just quotes the code section, so I think it's confusing. And I think it would be good to have a reference to the density bonus law in the replacement housing ordinance. But I understand that, you know, it's really a cleanup. It's not substantive. And so I think our recommendation was that the next time the staff puts together a number of cleanup items for the that be included. So I just wanted to check with you, Matt, that, you know, you had talked about recognizing that that was an issue, but it really wasn't high on the priority list. Is that a good approach to just sort of keep it in the back of your mind in terms of when cleanup is going to be done?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I do agree with you. That is the preferred staff position on that. We do anticipate doing a cleanup at some time this year, probably a little bit later after a number of priorities we're working on, spring and early summer clear up. So that is something that could be easily included and incorporated into our cleanup. And I think that would be the best approach to do it at that time rather than separate, since state law supersedes and we're certainly aware of it. So it's something that isn't problematic moment,
well,
or requires prioritization.
The CBRI project, which is why I think it would be good to have it more explicit. But it is in the ordinance, so it's not like the ordinance doesn't recognize it. It's just that the only way to know that is to go back to the state law. Okay. Does anybody else have any comments on subcommittee reports? I don't know, Commissioner Dawson, did you have anything to report on the West Cliff TAC? Are you now getting information from staff?
I am getting information, but there's no new updates. Things are just still proceeding, and don't have any new information to share.
Okay, thank you. So, not hearing from anybody else, we'll move on to items referred to the agenda. Are there any additional items that anybody wants to talk about? Hearing none, I would say we're adjourned. Thank you all very much. Sorry, Commissioner Conway, for the connection.
We'll figure it out in peace next time.
He does this in again. So,
yeah.
We may not be meeting, I guess, on March 4th, unless something comes up, so it may be about a month before we meet again. But until then, maybe within that time period, it will be possible for the House. thank you all very much, and we are adjourned.